Existentialism is its own brand of philosophy, so to speak. Okay, we're going to talk about that topic now. It's a philosophy that emphasizes human existence as subjective individuals is more important than what we have in common objectively with other human beings. And sort of a catchphrase is human existence supersedes human essence. Do you see the difference in emphasis here? Where instead of emphasizing, you know, the epistemological stuff we've been talking about or metaphysical stuff that we've talked about, it's emphasizing more of the fact that you exist, that you experience things as an individual, and just appreciating that aspect and emphasizing that element, and instead of trying to figure out all the, you know, what are we made out of, you know, what can we know, all these kind of questions that we've talked about. So it's sort of a shift in emphasis. We'll talk about a few different aspects of here. Let's talk about the founder, Søren Kierkegaard. I don't have the, that's not exactly how his name is really spelled, but we won't get into that. But it's pronounced Søren Kierkegaard. And he's considered the father of existentialism. Now, ironically, we have a term for it, don't we? We call it existentialism, all right? One of the things that Kierkegaard was really trying to get away from was being labeled, being put in a corner and, you know, having people say, this is your philosophy. He really tried to avoid that. He wrote under pseudonyms. He wrote under false names, you know, alias names at points in time to try to avoid drawing attention to, okay, this is Kierkegaard, this is his belief system. He was really trying to avoid that. He didn't want to be locked into a category of, you know, you believe this, and you know every little detail of his philosophy, quote unquote. So it's kind of interesting, you know, that ultimately he gets lumped into it, and he has followers that don't believe, you know, much of anything the way he did, but pick up that basic existential perspective. He was deeply troubled about spiritual matters. He was a Christian. He struggled with the whole concept of faith and believing, you know, this rational approach to faith that we've talked about previously. And that's why one of the reasons we want to talk about Kierkegaard in the philosophy of religion is because he basically says it's all a waste of time to try to rationally prove God. Forget that. You can't have faith based on rationality. He says you have to take a leap of faith. It is completely faith-based, and you cannot rationalize yourself into believing these things. So he gets away from what Kant, you know, even the moral approach that we saw with Kant and some of the other approaches with Thomas Aquinas and so forth. He gets away from that, and he basically says you can't do that. It's a waste of time, and you shouldn't bother trying to talk about spiritual matters, God, things of this nature, based on rationality. He became a pastor later in his life at his father's request. This was something that he acquiesced and did. He wrote books criticizing the established Christianity of his time. This was more of the, again, that rational, I understand rationally, I have this belief system, and yet people kind of doing whatever they want to do, living how they want to live, this kind of thing. He was really more critical of that. So he attacked it pretty much openly in his writings. Okay.
The hypocriticalness?
Well, to some degree, the hypocrisy, just more of that intellectual faith, which ultimately is tied to a hypocritical kind of hypocrisy, meaning pretending to be something, or literally it means to put a mask on, but that actor kind of concept, you know, people pretending, acting, you say you're this, but, you know, intellectually, but, you know, that's not, you know, so that was something he didn't have much appreciation for. He believed that rationalistic attempts to prove God were futile, as we already mentioned. He promoted that leap of faith approach to spiritual beliefs. A reality check here. I mentioned this. I think one of these days I'll get a tombstone and put it on there as a little symbol. He was preoccupied with the inevitability of his own death. You know, we can be relativist about a lot of things, but at the end of your life, there's one thing that won't be relative, and that is you're going to die, guaranteed. Even if you don't pay taxes, you're going to die, right? And that's kind of the way he thought about things. He was very concerned about death. He was concerned about, you know, is this belief system that I hold so dearly to really going to get me where I want to be when it's over? Is there really something there for me? Is this salvation that I'm promised, as he believed in the Bible, going to produce and be effective? Am I going to have a positive afterlife? This kind of thing. So he was a very deeply troubled individual when it came to things concerning death and the afterlife. All right? But on a flip side of that, not to say that one should be always preoccupied with death, but it is a fact that you're going to die one day. And some people don't think too seriously about that or think much about that. And that is something that I think is worthy of consideration. How are you going to live? What do you want? You know, when it's all said and done, you know, at the end of your life, what do you want to, you know, be known for? What do you want to be remembered for? Okay, any questions or comments about Kierkegaard or existentialism as such?